Okay, we're back. Internet conditions are a bit choppy, but I'll see how this gets on. At least it's a bit better than when I had to stop it there. Hope that's an improvement for you at home. That seems like the external mic might work. So Helen's asking, where is this one? This is at the Scottish Parliament in Edinburgh at Holyrood. So I better go over to the stage and see if they've got the PA up and running.
Absolutely. No, but there's Well, that's a half face, instead of facing them, right? And you pass it on. Excuse me, we're all going to turn our face that way because we don't want to face them.
I'm just thinking my internet's going up and down like a yo-yo.
Can you pass it on?
Maybe you could do offline recording.
We're all going to turn our backs on that lot, so...
I'm going against, I forgot that you said that. Don't worry about it.
We all face that way?
I might set one up and then hand it to you. Just for you to look after.
How do you want me to put you on?
Introduce. No, just more or less what I'm filming. My internet, I predict, will just fall away. And then.
Do you want me to stand here immobile and hold a phone?
No, just to. Well, anyhow, you don't worry about it until you're finished your speaking, and then we'll see how I'm getting on with it. So a bit like yesterday, we're having generator problems here to get the PA going, which is why there's not much happening at the moment, and I can't really let this music play out on the video, unfortunately. That's basically what's happening. Nothing much happening at the moment until they get the power to their PA system sorted out.
Union man said that we can't have a nation to build. Union man said that you'll starve if you're ill.
Union man
said we can't have a nation to build.
So close. Yes. Fuck you! Fuck you! Fuck you!
The mic's not working.
You'll be able to start again, Mike.
I am new, folks.
When I wake up, but I know I'm gonna be. Hope we don't get run over now.
Give a big shout out at the moment. The generator is fixed thanks to two Collins. Thank them. Yeah! Right, folks, where I was, halfway down to Edinburgh, I asked them to take a bell with them. And after that was finished, I said, and I'm not going to swear, let's build Scotland's freedom bell.
Yes! Yes!
My glamorous assistant is holding two iron brew cans, made out of girders, they say. How are we going to build the Freedom Bell? Out of aluminium. Now I'm going to try and keep my speeches short. I'm going to speak about the bottle as well, that's to do with currency. So I'm going to give you the Facebook pages where if you want details of what we're doing, how we're doing it, go to Scotland's Freedom Bell. Right. We're making it out of aluminium. Stage one, we're collecting aluminium cans from a lot of people. But I've dug myself into a hole, to be honest with you. Because I made a commitment to pick up all the cans wherever they were being collected. It's taken me as far south as Annandale, up north, all over. I can't afford to do that forever, so I've got a favour to ask everyone in the Yes movement. Who is going to our broth? Okay. I want everyone that's going to our broth to bring 2 aluminium cans. Simple as that, and you'll save me going bankrupt. I also want you to learn a chant. You know when Boris kind of says, "No, you canny." Yeah. Bang them together and say, "Oh, yes, we can." Start learning that, folks. Bring 2 cans. It'll also solve another problem. If I can divide by 2, I'll bring black bags. At the rally, come up with your cans, crush them, shout freedom. I'll divide by 2 all the cans there. And the gentleman across the road will get, "We can count." I'll tell you how many were at the rally. Some of you may recognise that. And you may have wondered exactly, David, what I'm coming on to, what happened. For those of you that don't know, a long time ago, I used to be involved in finance and money and investment. I stopped that and went into social enterprise because I've got a social conscience. That's why I mentioned sheer bloody determination. We have to get rid of the austerity regime, and we have to get rid of the empire that caused it. Yes. Down south. Yes. What I did, starting at, yes, Rutherglen, then going as far south as I could in Scotland, up as far as Orkney, and a lot of places in between, I asked people to put a pound coin in a bottle, and I asked them to sign a form which said, "I promise to honour a promise about currency." The page you want to go to is called The Scottish Hand. I painted my hand with a salt iron. That page, excuse me, that page is now closed for a reason. But if you go on to it, with the help of Kevin Gibney from Independence Live, you'll see me arrive at this Holyrood Parliament. I wasn't allowed in the back door, in the front door. I was told to go round to the back door. And I delivered the bottles with the coins, 6 times I did it, into the safe custody of the First Minister. She accepted it into the safe custody. I'll explain what the importance of that is in a wee minute. But I want to read you something that came from an article yesterday. In 2014, you maybe recognise who wrote this, Stuart Campbell. In 2014, this site had a clear and honest answer. For example, to give anyone who asked about what currency an independent Scotland would use, the pound. Realistically, in a currency union, or at worst, via sterlingisation. Since the fumble-fisted fudge festival of the Growth Commission report, we can no longer confidently tell anyone the same thing. We just don't know what the plan is anymore. I'm going to give you a plan. I'm going to let you see it. I stopped at the last hoop, hands off our parliament meeting, collecting any more pound coins. I got to the stage that I needed, which was to prove that you could start a central bank, that's what the bottle was, in that parliament. We did that, and it could be under the control of the First Minister. I stopped mainly because of the Growth Commission. I wanted to see what they would say. Now, one of the things that will not persuade a soft no voter is the Growth Commission. It's 360, I defy anyone to take 365 pages of economic, in my opinion, illiteracy, and persuade someone that they should vote yes. It won't happen. Commonweal have written a paper on it. It was done by Craig DL and another guy called Peter Ryan. If you haven't read it, read it. Andy Anderson is the person I'm probably closest to in my thinking. Andy has written books. If you get the chance, read them. Recently, and at the last SNP conference, Dr. Tim Rideout started challenging the Growth Commission. Now, all of these people have one thing in common. They don't think the Growth Commission is the answer.
No.
They also have one other thing in common, which is all of those papers relate to what we can do about currency after we get independence. I don't agree. I want to start a yes currency now.
Yes.
Now, what I'm going to try and do is a series of very short, very basic videos that you can watch. You'll see them on a Facebook page called Has Scotland Got the Bottle? And I mean that. I'm back to my sheer determination. If we show soft no voters that having your own currency will work and brings benefit, you'll persuade them not by issuing a paper 385 pages long, but by actually using a yes currency. Ruth Davidson will not use a yes currency, but all the way through what I've been doing, I have delivered letters, and you'll see it on the Facebook page, The Scottish Hand, to every one of the members of the Scottish Parliament, so that they know exactly what I'm going to try and do. One of the phrases I use is think big, currency is big, start small, but start now. And I'm going to give you one bit of economy, one bit of economic bit. You'll know that every year something comes out called GERS. And we all have a rampage about it. There's arguments this way and that way. What you'll also know is that every so often Derek Mackay will start talking about growth in the economy. And he talks about GDP, gross domestic product, what everyone does, whether it's you buying a fish and chips up on a Friday night, or whether it's Amazon putting their headquarters here to store stuff. That's gross domestic product. What no one talks about is a thing called, forgive me, it's all jargon, GNI, it's called gross national income. It's what's left in Scotland after we've done everything we can to keep our economy going. Something like 5% of everything we do leaves this country. Whether it's Trident, whether it's Buckingham Palace, whether it's HS2, we've got to start thinking about this. And one of the things I'm going to do, I'm not going to speak about it today, but there's another page which I've started. So I've got three things. I've got the bell, I've got currency. One of the letters I delivered, the very first one into the Parliament, said I've got those two objectives and I've got one other one. I'm going to show how to mitigate austerity. It'll probably be the biggest campaign that's ever been started in Scotland, because it calls for a boycott and a change. And I'll show you how you can save 5% leaving this country. I started that page this year and I'll finish on this. It's called X2. It's what it'll become known as. It's going to be a very random page. X is the Latin Roman numeral for 10. You all know that. 700 years ago, a letter was written. We all know that. That's why we're going to our broth. It was written in Latin. That's why I've used the X. And I put a 2 next to it, which could symbolise the second referendum vote we're all going to make. But if you look closely at the page, the 2 is up at the top. It's called X squared. That's my name for it. X squared is 10 by 10. That's the 100. And what I'm going to do is choose small numbers of people to sit down with me. We'll video it and I'll take you from the bottom up how to do the things I'm talking about, whether it's collect the aluminium cans and bring them to our broth, whether it's watch how a yes currency can be developed. If you read Tim Rideout, Tim's doing a lot of good work in this. If you read him, he says we need a central bank under the control of the Parliament. I've done that. He says we need our own currency. I'm going to produce that. He says we need a separate Scottish payment system. If you go on the page, you'll see me using a smartphone on a payment system which is not connected to the Bank of England. It's completely Scottish and it'll be used. Thank thanks for very much for listening. Thanks for being patient this morning when we got the generator going. See you in a broth. Two cans, everyone, please. Sir Alba.
I'm a short person, so this definitely wasn't made for me. Our next speaker is Stuart McMillan, MSP.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm here representing English Scots for Yes. I've got a confession to make. I'm English. As you can tell, I've still got the accent. No, I haven't. I was born in Barrow-in-Furness. I was 2 and a half when my family moved back to Scotland, moved back to Port Glasgow. I consider myself to be very much Scottish, but I also appreciate the fact I was born in England, and there are many people in Scotland who are born in England. There are many people in Scotland who are born in many other countries. And we want Scotland to become just like any other normal country, an independent country. And for us to act... And for us to win that fight, for us to win our independence, we need to convince more people, people who are born in Scotland, but also people who are born anywhere else, of the merits of independence. For me, I'm a pup at campaigning for independence. I've only been doing it for 27 years. And I'm a pup compared to many others. I joined the SNP 27 years ago because I believed that Scotland's right should be as an independent nation. Not because I'm against anybody, not because I'm against any country or against any grouping of individuals, but because I believe in the right of Scotland to become independent, to take its own decisions and make our own future. And as somebody who is an English Scot, I believe that type of message coming from someone who wasn't born in Scotland is such a powerful message. Now, I do not have the accent of an English Scot, but there are many people who do still have their English accent. I probably never had it because, I said, I was only 2 and a half when we moved back to Scotland. But at the same time, I don't care what accent somebody has. I don't care where they come from. And as Bashir Ahmed said in that building, and I was in the room when he said it in one of our group meetings, and the run-up, our referendum a number of years ago, Bashir Ahmed said, it's not where we're from, it's where we're going together. Yes. Now, irrespective of our place of birth, irrespective of our nationality, irrespective as to our religion, our faith, wherever we're from, it's about Scotland becoming the better nation, it's about Scotland becoming the nation that we all know it can be, and the nation that we can all be fully 100% proud of, because it's about making the lives of people in this country better. I represent the wonderful constituency of Greenock and Inverclyde. I've been an MSP now since 2007. I am proud every single day to go into our nation's parliament to take decisions to try to make the lives of people in my constituency, but also across Scotland, better. But at the same time, I know that one of our hands are tied behind our back, because we do not have the full powers that we need. The economic powers are hugely important to actually make things better. But at the same time, there are things that we have done and we still have made lives better for many, many people. Now, there's one thing I actually want to do just before I finish. There's a number of folk here today, and there's also people behind us demonstrating. I welcome the fact that they are there demonstrating, because I want to live in a democracy. I might disagree with what they have to say, and I do, but at the same time, they have the right to stand there and say their comments against us. But you know what? That's what a democracy should be. And in an independent Scotland, that's the type of democracy I also want to see happen. I don't want to stop people from demonstrating, because when people stop having the right to demonstrate, you then move away from democracy, and that's not the type of country I want to live in. And one final point. There are a number of you here today, and I'm delighted that so many of you are here. Can I ask you just to do one thing? Can you turn round to somebody who's next to you, somebody who you don't know, and introduce yourself and say hello and shake their hand? Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jerry.
Thank you for doing that. Thank you for indulging me. The reason why I asked you to do that is because, see, for us to win the fight for independence, we need to talk to more people. We are not yet over that threshold. All the opinion polls have shown it's around about 50%. Last week it was 51%. We've still got a job to do. We need to talk to more people. In my opinion, there's about 40% who will never ever come over to independence. There's the 45% from 2014, and I do not believe we've lost any of that. We've lost maybe some people, but we've gained others. But there's that batch of people in the middle that we still need to convince.
Yes.
And what happened last night at 11 o'clock, for me, is a game changer.
Yes.
I studied in France, Germany, and also in Sweden. I am still a European. I don't believe in Little Britain. I believe in a larger Europe. Europe is not perfect, no system is. But being part of a European Union, I know how beneficial it actually was for me, having the chance to go and study elsewhere. I went through the Erasmus scheme when I did my honours degree, and the European Social Fund when I went and did my masters. Now that we have left, and the fact that there is no guarantee that these schemes are going to be delivered in a post-EU Britain, that worries me for many younger people in our country who want to go to university, who want to go to college, who want the chance to go and study somewhere else to improve their languages. And when you go and study somewhere else, it's not just about that individual getting that opportunity. It's actually about the social opportunity that comes along with studying somewhere else, but also about people coming to study here. So if we are not in Erasmus, if we don't have an equivalent to the European Social Fund, our economy, our country will be poorer, both socially and economically. With independence, we can make Scotland better. With independence, we can rejoin the European Union. And with independence, we can make sure that our future generations, our young people, have the opportunities that some people are now not going to have. So please, talk to more people, convince more people, whether it's your friends, your family, your work colleagues, because we're not there yet, we've still got a job to do, and when we do have this second referendum, we need to win it, because there is not going to be a third in my lifetime, and I'm 47, and I want us to have our independence, so we can make the country we want it to be. Thank you very much.
Oh, don't we get this to short person height? Before we get to the next speaker, who's Steve Elwood of English Scots for Yes, this gentleman here's name is Graham Bell. We have an open mic session, so anybody who'd like to come and say a few words, if you could give your name to Graham for Yes Inverness and whatever organisation you may be associated with, and I'll introduce you to the mic, okay? Our next speaker is Steve Elwood from English Scots for Yes.
Hi there. As we've been told, I'm Steve Elwood. I'm not actually from English Scots for Yes, I'm just some random that came down because Graham asked me to. I came down here to make some noise. Because I'm not going to be told to shut up. do what you're told. I came here to stand up and be counted. Why is that important? I'll tell you why. It's because I'm a new Scot. As you can guess, I'm not from round here. I'm actually from the Highlands, from a wee town called Cromarty. That's where I'm from now. And that's what counts. Where I'm from now, where you're from now, where you're from now. It doesn't matter where you came from. We're here now. This is our country. We're going to make the decisions in this country for Scotland and for our countrymen, whether they're Scots or new Scots. We'll make the decisions. Decisions for Scotland, by Scotland, and in Scotland. Yes. Stuart mentioned earlier, 1320, the people of Scotland declared they were sovereign in their own land. No monarch, no lord, no prime minister, and indeed, no government tells us who rules us. It's Scotland's choice. Yes. Westminster in general, and the Tories in particular, think they've beaten us down. They haven't. We're not beaten down. We're not doing this. It's time to rise. We're not taking this nonsense from the Tories and their better together pals, the Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats. It's time to stand up. I'm not going to be knocked down by Westminster. I'm not going to see you knocked down by Westminster either. Side by side, foot to foot, we're going to stand together. We're being told we can't have a referendum. We're told we made a choice in 2014. That was 6 years ago. We chose to stay in Europe. We didn't choose austerity. We didn't choose nuclear weapons. We didn't choose the Labour Party with their one MP. We didn't choose the Liberal Democrats and we got shot of their arrogant leader. Most especially, we didn't choose the Tories. We didn't choose the Tories and we haven't since 1955. The Tories put the India referendum on the ballot paper for the election. They lost again. The choice of an independent Scotland isn't the Tories or their wee pals. To be fair, it's not the SNPs or the Scottish Greens either. It's Scotland's choice. Yay! That's your choice, my choice, the choice of the people who make Scotland their home. The people of Scotland decide who rules us. This isn't England. This is Scotland! Here we're the people. It's Scotland's choice. I'm told there's going to be a constitutional convention. And our views will be tested. My councillor knows my views. My MSPs do. The MP, those who were my MEPs knew. The power isn't in their hands. The power's not in Westminster's hands. It's not in Holyrood's hands. It's in our hands. The power is in our hands. We will not let them take it. Resist the power grab. It's Scotland's choice, and we, the people of Scotland, choose independence.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That was wonderful. Now, a wee quickie for Pat Lee, who's got an announcement to make, so I'll let him do it because the news just come in. And then he can get half a mic and give me a shot.
Right, folks, I've just come from the Marriott Hotel where Unison, Scotland's Public Service Union, has just voted in favour of supporting Scotland's right to choose. Yeah! Now, that's very significant.
Who voted for that?
That is very significant because Unison is 1.4 million members strong and represents over 150,000 members in Scotland. So we have the momentum behind us. We cannot leave it simply to the politicians. We have the ability to garner ourselves as a movement and turn it into a political force to support those who support independence in Scotland. Yes. Now, I'm not going to talk too much. I think it's a significant announcement that Unison have come on board and support the right of the Scots to choose the government of their determination. But tomorrow, we have another meeting in Glasgow for the People's Alliance. And I want you all to come or send a representative because we can do this together and we will only achieve independence as one. The time has come. Our time is now.
Yeah. That's good news, isn't it, folks? Yeah. Right, the next speaker was supposed to be Peter Bell. Just before, I didn't give you the address. We're meeting at the Renfield Centre in St. Stephen's Church, 240 Bath Street, between 1 and 4. Please come along. Right, now the part's still waffling. The next speaker was supposed to be Peter Bell, but unfortunately he's got another appointment and it took us a while to get a generator going. So I'm going to fill in for him, but I need to get into character, folks. And I promise I won't swear. In the truck, Davey, out the truck at Holyrood! For me, folks, it's about democracy.
Yes!
If we cannot fulfil manifestos of the governments that we elect because of Westminster, that makes our democracy a second-class democracy. And that is not acceptable to me, to you, to anybody in any sovereign nation. If we vote for a government on a manifesto to hold a referendum, there is nobody has the power to stop us. Nobody. The people are sovereign. We did not vote to leave the European Union. Our democracy should be observed. Now, we hear all that stuff about it was a UK-wide vote. It wasn't a UK-wide vote. It was a union-wide vote. And that union is made up of four composite parts. Two nations, a principality and a province. And each member state or member parts vote should be respected. So for me, this is about democracy. I guess it's his democratic right to rev up bloody engine. So for me it's as simple as that. This is a democratic thing. If we are going to be a nation state, then we must ensure that our democracy is respected at home and abroad. And when I say abroad, I mean, you know, Westminster, because they're definitely foreign to us. Yes. Okay, we're going to move on to the open mic section.
Yeah.
Who's up first? We've got Mr. Sean Clerkin from Action for Scotland. Oh, hold on, I'm not finished, Sean. I need to round up. So, Indy Truck Davey, out the truck at Holyrood. The sun's up, it's about 10 degrees. Have a nice day.
And he didn't swear, right?
We are at a very historical time in our nation. And basically, this is the time for decisions. Do we wait for another referendum into the year 2021? Why say no to that? Because this is the 700th anniversary of the Declaration of Scottish Independence, and we must have a grassroots rebellion, a democracy rebellion, where we hold a referendum, a consultative referendum on Scottish independence this year, not next year. Also, Westminster austerity has caused a million of our people to live in poverty. 250,000 children living in poverty, been forced to go to 58 food banks where there was none in 2008. And the situation is, we have children suffering from malnutrition, and we have many, many thousands suffering from homelessness in all our towns and cities, and we must have independence to get rid of the Growth Commission. We must have our own central bank and our own currency from day one, yes, which is not the pound, and Scotland makes the decisions, nobody else. We are sovereign. We must be free this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean, for your points of view.
Julie.
Christy. Next speaker has never spoken publicly before, so a wee bit of courtesy, she's a little nervous. It's Julie Christie.
Right, okay. 3 messages for the 1st of February 2020. Holyrood, my badge, and an idea for the future. Today, we are gathered outside our Parliament, the most vulnerable building in Scotland.
Yes!
Alongside the Senate in Wales and Stormont in Northern Ireland. Vulnerable because of a group of right-wing, egotistical ERG Conservative MPs. That bit was, the next bit censored from Graham. Whose pursuit of Brexit in Westminster has resulted in Scotland leaving the EU against our will. 62%, as you know, voted to remain. Michel Barnier was correct when he said that the UK government failed to educate the people about the benefits and principles of the EU. In March 2018, we joined hands around our Parliament building to send a message to Westminster. Hands off our Parliament. In 2020, it's unbelievable that we need to be more than vigilant. Otherwise, the words of Winnie Ewing in 1999, and I quote, "The Scottish Parliament adjourned on the 25th day of March in 1707 is hereby reconvened." Well, those words may no longer hold. The parcel of rogues in Westminster, supported by our now 6 Tory MPs, will not adjourn our Parliament, but do everything in their power to destroy it. For today, I've removed all my badges except for one. And the illustration depicts two butterflies facing each other, one with the saltire painted on its wings and the other with the EU flag. Since 1973, I have lived in the EU, travelled in the EU, have friends and family in the EU, marched with John Mellon in Berlin in the EU. correct. I am an Anglo-Scot because of World War I-II. Scots know all about bloodshed in their own country, across the continent and beyond. The premise of which the common market was built pre-EU was peace through trading nations rather than making war. Our Celtic ancestors knew this truth. The Gaelic word for peace is she, S-I-T-H, pronounced she. She is a type of Celtic fairy or fairy hill, as in Glen She or peace. And on my badge are five words. Peace in an equal union. I'll repeat that. Peace in an equal union. Finally, at a Yes Highland meeting last September, my colleague from Yes Inverness, Alistair MacDonald, whom I've met this afternoon, after a roundtable discussion on how to engage and persuade voters, suggested we become ambassadors for Scotland, and he gave two reasons. Engage with our tourists, international visitors, and our diaspora, we shouldn't forget about them, to enable support for the cause worldwide. The more challenging, of course, is with our no voters. And indeed, how can 54 MSPs vote against continuing to fly the EU flag?